In the absence of a visible feminist movement in the public discourse, our inspirations were the private spheres. It was our grandmothers and our mothers and the lives they led and the injustices we saw there, because public mein to women don't exist, a feminist discourse doesn't exist. So all these women, younger women, knew what was happening in their house. So what ended up happening was, it was thousands of wounded women now coming to the city squares with their wounds, and they'd be like, yellow, this is what's happening. And without knowing, we were actually challenging family as an institution. Growing up, when I was, you know, when I was a teenager, I was all about myself as a teenager, because that was the way to rebel for me. And I think that is how it is for many women, you know, because you're so subjugated in a way and dominated that you want to be. There was a time when I wanted to be a model. And that is what that was what I was going to do, to rebel against the norms. And I did that for a very short period of time. But then I realized that maza nahi aa raha. This is not bringing me what it should bring me. I'm not enjoying just being like this me self. And then I realized, like, I'm not the only woman. My feminism can perhaps start from me, but it cannot end there. I am not the subject of my politics. I can be, I was big in the beginning when my feminist awakening was sort of happening, but eventually it got boring for me. I was like, this is borderline self-obsession. And I didn't want to do that. And that is why I also started organizing, because for me, organizing is where the leadership was really at. Because I think leadership is about leading people, leading a collective, not about leading yourself, being the champion yourself, being known as the 10, you know, most brave women of Pakistan. I didn't want to be one of the brave women of Pakistan. I for me, it was about women of Pakistan being brave in who they were. So I started working with the Awami Workers Party. I remember for the first 2 years, I didn't utter a word. I would go to everything, just sit and listen, not ask any questions. I was 21, 22 at that time. I had been going to protest much before that, since I was 17 or 18. But I'd never thought of formally joining, because before that I would go when, you know, something would happen. There was the Mukhtara Mai rape case in Pakistan, which got really popular and we all heard about it. So I was like, no, I'm going to go. So I used to go to those, like, you know, issue-based protests whenever they used to happen. So I would go for that. But this, I was in dental school when I formally joined. And then, yeah, 2-3 years later, I started speaking also. Okay, I started asking questions about things, and then I started reading, and then I realized that my entire life kind of started revolving around politics and the next meeting and what's going to happen and what are we planning. And somewhere there, like, people around me in the party started pushing me to speak more. And I used to get so nervous that I would sweat and melt. Every time I would be asked to speak. Sometimes I'd be like, mujhe chakkar aa raha hai, I can't speak. I'm, you know, my head is spinning. I'm not feeling well, so I'm not speaking today. So it went on for a while, and then eventually I realized that shuru mein to it all felt like a utopia. And then I started seeing that there was something also missing here. And then I started doubting myself again, like, okay, what's missing now? And then I realized that despite the fact that I was in the left, there was still sexism somewhere there, like, very subtle. It was never like, you know, in your face. It was subtle. And at that point, there were other women who were also talking about this within the left, but not as much as I was. Because I was younger, they had been around for much longer. So I think they were somehow, you know, used to of some things. They could also kind of like ignore certain things. It was difficult for me to ignore. Sometimes there were like subtle hints of making women uncomfortable, not just in the party, but larger left. And I realized that in other parties, in other organizations, there was only one, at most you would find one woman. So, I mean, within Awami Workers Party, I still had women with me. There were two, three women, at least prominently, in the city that I was working in. But sometimes we would go to an event to press club and I was the only woman there if the other two didn't come. And that made me think, like, why are women not here? Why am I here and other women not being able to make it? And at that point, like a lot of us, like the other women and, you know, women from the larger party also started thinking about these questions. Okay, why is it that we don't have enough women in the left? And in 2016, some women in Sindh and other parts of the country started organizing autonomously. And initially they called it Nari Jamhuri Mahaz. Nari, in Sindhi, Nari is woman. So they started organizing, and then, you know, we had a lot of talks like within ourselves. It was just women speaking to each other. And we're like, we can be here because we are maybe made differently or we work, function differently. But it's probably not the kind of space where all women can be. So we decided we want to build an autonomous women's organization. And yeah, in 2018, on the International Working Women's Day, we did a foundational congress for Women Democratic Front. I met women from like across different small villages and districts, women who talked about feminism as if like it was their thing. And I felt that the way they spoke about it, it was so organic. It was so just like, you know, it's a thing that's just there, that's just part of their life. They didn't theorize it. They didn't use like difficult words for it. It was just something that they needed. It came more naturally to them than it did to many of us. Women Democratic Front is not very big, but it is probably the biggest feminist organization in Pakistan in that sense. So we are a couple of thousands, maybe 2,000, not more than that. And demographically, most of our membership is based in Sindh, because that's where it started from. That's where women are more political anyway. We have not been able to organize in Balochistan. We did work in Balochistan. We have members in Balochistan, but Baloch women, I think we only have one or two Baloch women who are part of Women Democratic Front in Balochistan. There are others who live, if they live outside Balochistan and they've been raised and brought up in cities, then they are members. And it's got nothing to do with being conservative or not allowed to do politics. It has got more to do with the fact that because there's a nationalist movement in Balochistan, so they would not want to be part of an organization which is federal or believes in a federation. So Balochistan is the place where we have probably the least number of members. And the biggest demographic is from Sindh. Islamabad is also very active. And also in Karachi, which is, you know, in Sindh, Karachi also has, a bigger membership in that sense. Lahore, not as much, but we are, you know, organizing these days in Punjab, in Lahore. We also have units in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Most of the membership of Women Democratic Front is based where Awami Workers Party is based. Because it was through the support of certain men in the party that we were able to get access to the communities or to the women, because some of these men had been working for a very long time. So it was very important that they convince the men that it is okay for this organization to work. Just having more women around and also knowing that sometimes we could just talk about women. I'm still as involved with the party because somewhere deep down, I still don't just want to talk about women. I also see a lot of value in the party. There's a lot that Women Democratic Front, for example, can't do that the party can do. And I think for us, the major point came when in 2018, we decided to hold a foundational congress for Women Democratic Front in Islamabad. So the members of Women Democratic Front, some of them saved for 6 months for the train ticket to come to Islamabad and have this foundational congress. So we decided, okay, we are going to march. It's going to be a women's march. After the congress, we're going to go out on the road and march. And then we heard that Karachi women, random women in Karachi are also planning to march. And then next thing we know, a week later, women in Lahore are also planning to march. And we're like, it was all a coincidence. I think the women in Karachi were inspired by the women's march in USA. And ours was just like associated with our own event. And we marched. So in 2018, we marched and random women came to our march. And we're like, oh, what happened? Like, how come we were more than we were? They're popularly all known as the Aurat March because they all happen on the same day. So in Islamabad, it was known as the Aurat Azadi March, and in Lahore and Karachi, Aurat March. And then the next year, Women Democratic Front members in Hyderabad and in Quetta and Peshawar, they also decided they'll march, and they also called it Aurat Azadi March. So now Aurat Azadi March was happening in 4 or 5 cities, and Aurat March was happening in 3 or 4 cities also. We're not marching because we're women. We're marching because we want emancipation. We are talking about liberation. We want liberation. We don't want rights. We don't want empowerment. Because for a very long time, the feminist movement in Pakistan, at least 20 years before this started, it was very depoliticized. It was all about, you know, the empowerment sort of narrative. And I think with the Aurat marches happening, whether it was the Aurat March, Aurat Azadi March, they brought the politics back in the feminism of the country. I think the first time I realized that I am a South Asian was in 2016 when I got selected for the Sangat course. The first time I realized that I belong to something more than beyond my national border. And there's something like, there's an identity called the South Asian identity. And I remember that when I went and I spoke to my mother about it, I was like, Mama, I went as a Pakistani, but somehow I feel I came back as a South Asian. And it had a very big impact on me. Like, I always knew humans are not fundamentally bad. It was very naive for me to think, the Indians won't like me or the Bangladeshis won't like me, we won't get along. I could relate more to, you know, the Bangladeshis and Indians. And that was very surprising for me. I was like, how is that even possible that the women who do not come from my country, not from my so-called culture, how come it's possible that I can, you know, form such meaningful friendships with them? I was having a very difficult time understanding how are they thinking like me, you know, why are they having issues with the same things that I am having issues with? Because we're supposed to be different, right? However much you resist, like, you know, your national identity, it's still there. And the kind of pains that we've given each other as countries, especially with Bangladeshis. So, you know, there was a lot of shame. And I was not sure if I'm supposed to be friends with them. I did learn more about feminism and feminist politics in my South Asian sort of like, you know, comrades, with my South Asian comrades, than I did perhaps in Pakistan. When I was doing feminist politics in Pakistan, our scope was very limited. What we could learn from each other was also very limited because we did not have, you know, we didn't succeed anyone really. 20 years, there was nothing. So to come and see other feminists who were dealing with, who were problematizing literally everything. Her law pe masla tha Indians ko, jo progressive bhi pass ho raha tha. So I was like, what? Like, okay, iski bhi nuance hai. Ye jo achha wala law hai, like, is there nuance to that as well? So, you know, I learned a lot of like critically looking at law, critically looking at state. I mean, it's easier to look critically at state if you're from Pakistan, but still, like, you know, the progressive, so-called progressive legislation, how to analyze that, how to look at that, how to look at border regimes. Why is it so important to have open borders? Why is it important to share ideas, to share strategies, to talk about the regional politics? And I feel like with, you know, with everything that's happening now in South Asia, with the, you know, authoritarian, rise of right-wing authoritarianism, majoritarianism. I feel there's a lot that we could tell each other, share with each other, learn and maybe resist. And I feel like abhi, one of the very big issues that we're not able to move forward is because we are not talking to each other like we should be. Because there's so much power in, you know, regional collectives. And we see it happening in Latin America, for example. One movement picks up and, you know, it goes across, like, it becomes transnational. And I feel like that is something that our region desperately needs right now. Especially the women's movement. Also the left movement, but I feel especially the feminist movement, especially the women's movement. It's not a choice we have that to do it or to not do it. I feel like it's essential to our survival at this time.